breakfast with their helpers. Not only gets the gospel message through to the children, but how in the world did you plan to have exactly six children to spell out Easter? Soldiers thought they were done. Jesus is dead on the cross. They thought it a little strange that they were asked to guard the tomb. They wondered what kind of worries this man had that he thought something like would disturb the tomb. But they did their duty. They thought they were done. The disciples thought they were done too. Jesus is dead. He's buried. What are we going to do? But God said, I'm not done. John, the gospel writer, really gives us two stories in our gospel lesson this morning. First, Mary Magdalene comes to the tomb. It's still dark. She wants to finish up the job that they started. They couldn't finish on Friday. Saturday was the Sabbath, you weren't supposed to work. She gets close to the tomb and notices that that big rock, millstone, had been rolled away. And she assumes only what you could assume. Somebody has disturbed the tomb. She goes running back, she tells Peter and John. And then we have that famous foot race between Peter and John. The younger John gets there first. The older Peter, probably huffing and puffing, gets there. But John doesn't go into the tomb. It's Peter who charges ahead like he always did and goes into the tomb. And they behold, the body's not there. Mary Magdalene is standing outside of the tomb, weeping. The last thing she wanted was something to disturb Jesus in his final rest. Why are you weeping? Mary thought he was the gardener. If you move the body, let me know and I'll take care of it. I won't say that. Mary, he says. And it was that saying of her name, the way Jesus said it, I'm sure she recognized it. This is Jesus. He was dead. We saw it all. But there he is, standing. They're alive. Ordinary things in people's lives. Going to a cemetery. Seeing a problem. Trying to help. Being afraid. Not understanding what's going on, confusion, tears, asking a man to help and a man thinks he can help. Ordinary things in ordinary people's lives. And then suddenly, God comes in. Bang! Everything collides. isn't what people expect. Jesus risen from the dead. This is the good news that we celebrate. The resurrection of Jesus Christ. Last Saturday, or yesterday, I should say, I observed the wedding of my great-great-grandparents, George Stump and Mary Ann Smith, in 1849. I can, with all confidence, tell you that in all the world, I was the only one that observed their wedding. Because who cares about George and Mary Ann, as far as the world is concerned? It only means something to me. But the resurrection of Jesus Christ is an anniversary that affects and touches the hearts and lives of every single human being on the face of the earth. Amen. Whether they believe it or not, Amen. Jesus' resurrection is the greatest thing that has come to man. J.J. Jameson came to Chicago about 25 years ago. Nobody knew him. He was an outsider. He wrote a little poetry. He worked hard at the jobs that he had. And in fact, he was named Poet of the Month in Chicago. I don't know if that's a big thing. It's the first and only time I've ever heard of it. But it shows that he did something. Then, about a week after he was named Poet of the Month in Chicago, Illinois state policemen visited his home and arrested him. Not under the name of J.J. Jameson, but under the name of Norman Porter. You see, Norman Porter had killed two people and was convicted of their murder and was serving a life sentence in the Massachusetts State Penitentiary in Norfolk. When one day, Norman decided he had enough. He escaped, went to Chicago, and in his own words, he said, "I laid aside Norman Porter and became J.J. Jameson." For 20 years, he eluded capture. Justice finally came up. He could not outrun us. Just like we cannot outrun in time or distance our own sinful lives. Your sins, my sins. We faced the altar just a few minutes ago and we said, "I, a poor, miserable sinner." Because that's who we are. We are miserable sinners. And the perfect justice of God requires the punishment of that sin. But thanks be to God, he takes that punishment we deserve, puts it on Christ and the cross. Amen. And his own dear son pays the full penalty, not a partial penalty, the full penalty, so that we might have life. Amen. Not just life, in some abstract way, but eternal life, the resurrection from the dead that will come to us who believe in Jesus as our Lord and Savior. That's the good news. Lynette Stewart, age 35, one day bought one of those scratch and match lottery tickets, and she scratched and was surprised to find out she won $300,000. Woo! I'm surprised Roosevelt didn't give up. Woo! Yeah. As well as about 3,000 other people who scratched and matched and won $300,000. You see, the lottery office was a little embarrassed. They apologized and said there was just not fair. And she's right. It's not fair. There's a lot of things in life that are not fair. But we put our trust and our love in Christ, who has overcome all things for us. There's no typographical error in the scripture when it promises us eternal life in Jesus Christ. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, for since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen.